Hi, my name is Adam Haney. I've been a mortgage loan officer for 22 years, and I work for a mortgage brokerage in Newport Beach, California called Emory Financial that opened in 1993. Now, the purpose of this video is to help explain what has happened here recently in our mortgage market and also to help you set expectations. Whether you're a realtor working with clients or whether you're a homeowner or a potential home buyer, it's important to see, understand what has happened here recently so that you can position yourself to deal with this as we move ahead, because it's a very fluid situation going on with the coronavirus and how it's affected our markets. So I'm going to bring up a quick chart here from our friends at MBS Highway, led by Barry Habib, who's probably the premier expert of the mortgage market in the entire country. But, you know, after all, a picture's worth a thousand words. So this picture here, I brought it up numerous times now and tried to explain it. I feel like I'm coming across a car accident and trying to, you know, explain what happened. The first part of this chart is pretty easy to decipher. Basically, it shows that the price of mortgage bonds have risen somewhat steadily, swiftly, up through the end of February to the first week of March, resulting in the lowest interest rates that we have ever seen, at least since 2012. And the rates over that 2 month period of time dropped probably about 0.75%. So a lot of people got locked in at some really low rates, and that was great. But then in the second week of March, the wheels essentially fell off the cart. And really what this has to do with is a capacity issue. So what you need to understand is that there are approximately $11 trillion worth of mortgages outstanding in the entire country right now. And of that $11 trillion, with the rates having dropped as precipitously as they did over these last 2 months, there were probably $5 trillion of those that were eligible to refinance into a lower rate. Okay. The problem with that, however, is that the entire mortgage industry as a whole can only do about $2.5 trillion worth of mortgages in an entire year. And that's for both purchases and refinances. So here we had $5 trillion worth of mortgages trying to refinance in 60 days when the industry as a whole can only do about half of that in a whole year. And that's assuming that everything's firing on all cylinders, you know, not having, you know, stay at home, shelter at home alerts from the coronavirus. So the industry has been operating or trying to operate under very crippled circumstances. So after that first week of March, as I say, the wheels sort of fell off the cart and the rate shot up by 1%, which was very confusing to a lot of people, because all most people are hearing in the headlines is how rates have gone down and that rates are at their all-time lows. And we're seeing things like the Fed did an emergency 0.5% rate cut on March 3rd, and then on March 15th, lowered the Fed funds target rate between 0.25%. So that causes major confusion for consumers, because they hear that things like the Fed cut the rates by 0.5% and assume that that means mortgage rates just dropped by 0.5% too. But that's not how it works. And the Fed funds rate does not have a direct impact on 30-year fixed mortgages or even 15 or 20-year fixed mortgages. So with that announcement, again, it created a lot of confusion. It caused a lot of borrowers who may have already locked a loan, said they wanted to lock in a particular rate, to maybe jump ship, because now they think they should be able to get a lower interest rate somewhere else. When they did that, basically it sort of clogged the system at a time when the system really cannot afford to be clogged up. It's trying to deal with this major capacity issue, and now all of a sudden you have borrowers jumping around to, you know, different lenders who are maybe halfway or two-thirds of the way through the loan process, and now maybe trying to renegotiate their rate locks or go to a different, you know, lender and see if they can get a lower rate. So that was part of the problem. But the real issue, certain things are happening behind the scenes that have made lenders very illiquid, and that has curtailed their lending capability to lend more money, which is why we're seeing the interest rates up when, by all counts, we would expect them to be lower now. And one of the things that has happened is that loan servicers' pipelines, their servicing value has dropped tremendously. Because if you think about it, one of the ways that lenders make money is the servicing of the loans that they currently have. And if these rates come down, there's a major rush for all those loans to refinance and go into lower interest rates, perhaps with a different lender. Now, some of that is recovered because, of course, as they're losing loans that are being refinanced, they may be also gaining new loans. The problem, however, is that a loan servicer pays about 1% for the rights to service that loan. And then for every year they have that loan, they get about a 30 basis point strip, okay? So understand that the loan servicer doesn't own the loan. The owner of most loans in this country are Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. Really Fannie Mae, but Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac are the two government-sponsored agencies that own a majority of the loans. They're the end investors. All the loan servicer is doing is simply sending out statements to the consumer, collecting those payments from the consumer, and then forwarding them on to Fannie Mae. And so it takes loan servicers about 3 to 4 years to break even on the costs that they spent in order to acquire those servicing rights. So if somebody bought a home or refinanced a home 2 or 3 or 4 months ago and is already trying to refinance it, lenders take a very significant loss because they have this major runoff of their books and they haven't had a chance to recoup hardly any of the money they've invested into those loans. So that's one of the ways that lenders are taking a hit that is resulting in higher interest rates right now. Another thing that's happening behind the scenes has to do with margin calls. So this has to do with lenders trying to hedge positions on interest rates that are locked. So it gets very complicated, especially when consumers request to lock in a specific rate and then they bail out and they jump ship and they try to chase a lower interest rate somewhere else. The lender incurs a real cost. And so the margin calls have been excessive to the tunes of tens of millions of dollars here lately, which is causing a big strain. Then on top of that, for loan servicers, in this forbearance issue, how it affects them, we have forbearance for borrowers who qualify that potentially allows them to miss up to 3 payments. Well, they're not really going to skip those payments, but they're going to be added on to the tail end of the loan. So we'll have to pay them eventually, but it's going to give them 3 months worth of payment relief where they're not going to have to make a payment. So good for the homeowner, but not so good for the servicer, because the servicer is still on the hook to make the payments to the end investor, Fannie Mae or Freddie Mac or whoever it may be. So they're still obligated to make those payments even though they're not receiving any payments from the homeowner. So again, putting a huge squeeze on lenders and with their servicing. Now, to make matters worse, think of it this way. We've had a tremendous amount of people refinance already, and all of a sudden all these brand new loans. And then right after that, we get this forbearance announcement that potentially lets borrowers miss their first 3 payments. Well, if a borrower misses their first mortgage payment, that loan is no longer eligible to be sold to on the secondary market to Fannie Mae or Freddie Mac. That loan has to stay on the lender's line of credit, which is another huge strain on the lender, because now let's say it's a $400,000 loan, that's $400,000 less that they have available to turn around and lend out to somebody else because they have this other loan stuck on their line that they couldn't sell because the borrower missed their very first payment. So these are some of the issues that are going on behind the scenes that, and the reason why we're not seeing rates trickle down like we would hope that they would or should. On top of that, the Federal Reserve is not quite understanding the problem yet. I think they will after this weekend, because there's been some, much discussion and some intelligent articles written about it. But the Federal Reserve has tried to buy more mortgage-backed securities in an effort to help lower the rates. But what they've done is actually exacerbate the margin call situation that lenders are dealing with, making, even more of a strain. So just these are some of the things that are happening behind the scenes and why we don't have lower rates right now, and why it's probably going to take at least a couple, 3 weeks, if not longer, kind of depends, I suppose, on how long coronavirus takes effect, for the lower rates to come back. But I am confident that they will come back. And so the other important point that I want to make, especially for realtors out there and home buyers, is another unintended consequence of this forbearance program, which seems to be having a disparate impact on government loan borrowers. So government loans are FHA, VA, and USRDA, like for rural areas. So not so much of that USRDA in California, think of that more like the Midwest, but there are a lot of FHA loans and certainly a lot of VA loans. Now, the reason why the government loan borrowers seem to have been hit harder, in other words, they're seeing a disproportionately higher interest rate at this time, is because of the perception that government loan borrowers are a higher credit risk. Now, this is somewhat understandable when it comes to FHA loans, because FHA loans are, you know, the most common first-time home buyer loan. They allow lower credit scores, higher debt ratios, lower reserves. So it is a riskier borrower. But unfortunately, VA loans get lumped into this as well. And VA loans are not risky loans. Matter of fact, just the opposite. So despite the fact that veterans have earned the right to put zero down, VA loans are and have been the best performing loan of any loan out there, whether it's, you know, Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, Jumbo, FHA, VA loans perform very, very well. Unfortunately, they fall under this pool of Ginnie Mae loans and kind of getting this sort of bad rap of, you know, if anyone is going to sign up for the forbearance program, it's going to be a government loan borrower. Consequently, potential investors are treating that like a hot potato. Like, why would they want to, you know, sign up for that if the person's going to sign up to miss their very first three mortgage payments? So it is having a major impact on these government loan borrowers, these VA borrowers and FHA borrowers who would, should normally see much lower interest rates. And you need to know that if you're a realtor dealing with one of these loans, but certainly a home buyer, because if you started the process, you know, of a pre-qualification a couple months ago with the expectation of a certain rate, the rates have gone up and this could affect your transaction. So again, I believe that rates will come down in time. They have to, okay, to help dig us out of the situation. And so I just want to offer this little bit of insight and also some guidance suggestion for potential homeowners out there who may be thinking of a refinance, is to, one, pick a lender, one, and stick with him or stick with her through the process. Fill out your application early, submit all your income and asset documentation, and then pick a rate that you feel like you can live with. And when you choose to lock in that rate, resign yourself to close at that locked rate. And don't play the musical chairs game where you're jumping around from lender to lender and still shopping for rates even after you've locked, because that clogs the system and actually it makes it kind of worse for everyone. That's part of the reason why we have higher rates right now. It sort of messes it up. Same thing goes for potential buyers. Fill out your application now. Submit all your income and asset documentation. Don't wait until you find the perfect dream home, because by then it's, you know, probably too late. Get yourself in a position that you're in the queue and that you're positioned to, you know, one, take advantage of the right home and make that offer when it comes up. And then two, if you're looking to refinance, that you're got your loan already approved and all your documentation together so that you can lock and close at that rate that you chose to lock. So I hope this helps. And wish you well, stay safe. Of course, if you have questions, please don't hesitate to call or text or email me. Thank you.